Hey there everyone, N7CPO here, and in this video we're covering the install of the Icom 5100.
And we're doing it right now. That's right guys, this is an install video of the Icom ID-5100 into my 2015 Jeep Wrangler. I'll show you how I'm doing the install. This is an install video, not a why video, so I'm gonna cover the whys. In another video, I'm going to talk about communications, both licensed and unlicensed, what your options are, and why I chose what I chose. But this is a full-on UHF, VHF, amateur radio that I do have a license for. I'm a general class license holder, N7CPO. And don't worry, I'll do another video showing off the features of this Icom 5100, but I got to learn it first. I'll learn it, and then I'll show you the cool stuff. Let's get to it.
All right, before I start buttoning things up, I wanted to show you what I have run for the radio, basically power right now. So I'm coming off the battery directly. This is the hot line and this is the ground for the radio itself. The hot goes through a 30 amp circuit breaker right here. This is an 8-gauge wire and that's gonna go across where all my other wires go. And same place underneath the hole in the by the brake booster comes down, and then I have it running along this wire loom bundle here and across. And I actually have in here, it connects to the actual factory wiring that came with the harness that came with the radio. It has a 20 amp fuse. It's actually fused on the positive and the negative side. So I have that to where it ties in and bundles up right here. It's actually zip tied to stay off of the floor because I do get water infiltration from time to time. So I just wanted these off of floor level if I can keep them. It runs through and then I stop having it tied in right here because I'm still testing. This is going to run back through there along with that bundle, go inside my security enclosure, and the radio itself is going to mount back inside the security enclosure on the fender well. Yeah, that's that. Now this bracket that I have here, this is a bracket. You have to buy the bracket, unfortunately, for the unit itself. But I bought these magnets. These are those fishing magnets. I'll put a link in the description and a picture right here so you can see what they are. They're designed to, you know, put a line on or a rope and throw them into the water and pick up stuff out of the water. But because they use these little 5mm bolts with screw heads on them, I just went and took off those round loops for the line and got some 5mm Nylock nuts from Home Depot, and then use that to mount 5 of these bad boys. And my thought is, it's gonna give me a permanent-like fixture, but movable, because if you know anything about me, I change things up often, so can't hurt to have options. So just you can see like on this curve. So between all of these, they should hold fairly solidly. If I put it on a super solid piece of metal, I mean, it sticks good. But anyway, that's how that's gonna go. And by the way, these magnets are shielded, so on the top, there's hardly any magnetic stuff coming through. It's just on the bottom, so it shouldn't interfere with the radio at all. The head unit cable actually is long enough to reach the head unit up here in the front, and this is where I have this, and then this is just on a bracket using magnets. Again, another cool feature is this bracket, and I'm using a 67 Designs mount. My Trail Dash 2 used to be here, and I'm gonna relocate that and then use this for that. And the reason I like it as a magnet is because I can take it down when I'm not using it or when I leave the Jeep. I can put it someplace locked and secure, just unplug the cable, put this away, and then I'm good to go. So I guess let me power this on because it is plugged in right now for testing. And you guys can see the second power up ever. The first power up I did just to make sure I had everything running correctly. And so, yeah, it's actually has two separate radios, which is kind of cool. I'm waiting on a GPS lock here in a second, but I can use GPS to find local repeaters. I can use it to find my location. I can use it to identify other people's location. I don't have the external speaker plugged in, nor do I have the mic plugged in because I don't have my antenna on yet. I'm not really going to go through all of this with you right now, but it's pretty intense, the capabilities this thing has. So more to come on that. And again, that'll sit up right there. And then from the cockpit, I'll have access to see it, adjust it, do whatever I need to do whenever. So the next thing we're going to add is going to be the antenna. And again, that's going to go right here, feed through. And actually right now I'm going to run it the same place as the power. Now I know best practice says don't run your coax with your power. And I'm prepared for that to give me problems. And if it does, I have a couple of solutions in the works. I have one of these ferrite cores here that I can use. Wrap it around the power, and that might help. And if that doesn't work, my alternative will be to try and run the coax up along the top roll bar and then back down. But I want to avoid that if I can. I'd rather just have everything nice and clean. I know clean's relative because I don't even have carpet, but it's going to run along up with all this stuff. So that's the basic rundown of where I'm at today. And my buddy Chris is coming over tomorrow, and we're going to run the antenna. He's got an SWR meter for UHF VHF, and we're going to test the SWR just to make sure this A-pillar isn't so close to the antenna that it's going to give me some issues. And somebody did comment on my channel that that's a possibility, so I want to make sure we check that, which we were going to do anyway, but I'm just glad I have a smart guy that has all the right gear and equipment to help me out. All right, guys, for this bracket install, what I've done here, you know, if you watch my previous video of this Rugged Radios A-pillar bracket, you know that I cut out this rubber packing sheet here. And what I want to do is ensure I have a good ground, because I need my antenna to be grounded to the chassis of the vehicle. So I used a Dremel, and I basically Dremeled little circles where the washers went. For my test fit, I could see where these bolts left circles, and then I just basically used a sanding wheel and Dremeled that out. I did the same thing on the underside of these bolts, so that I've got good metal-to-metal contact for that. Now the other thing I did is on the bottom, where I'm going to be connecting my actual antenna coax, I've also ground that away. So I'm trying to get as much metal to metal contact as possible. And if I did a good job, hopefully we'll have a good ground. So while DC continuity isn't a exact one-for-one correlation, it does tell me if I'm getting at least some good grounding connection electrically, different than RF, but related in this fashion. So I'm getting good continuity from the bracket to the chassis ground. That at least tells me I'm going the right direction. If I got nothing, like here, then I would say I've got some work to do, but I'm getting good. And you probably can't hear that, but my continuity tester's beeping at me, telling me there's a connection. All right, the other thing I guess I need to tell you about is how I'm gonna run this. Yep. This cowl is welded to the fender, but there's a little space right here that I'm gonna fit this through, and we've gotta cut this end off to make that happen. It's okay, we're gonna cut it off anyway. I need a different size connector, so this guy. So we're gonna cut this off and solder that on. But before we do that, we're gonna run it through where I need to run it, so. Okay, so antenna cable is run. The coax goes through there, shoots across here. I still need to zip tie that. Goes down through the firewall and then comes along here and follows this other wire loom. My power's here, remember also. We know it's not ideal to run the coax and the power together, but let's see if I get away with it. Just in case, I do have this little guy set up here. I don't know if we'll need it or not, but I had it, so I figured I may as well throw it on there. And this is my buddy Chris. He's our resident expert in radio communications, I'll say. What's your official title other than expert?
I'm definitely far from an expert. Extra class amateur radio operator, have over 25 years experience playing with radios, building amplifiers, everything from playing with little two-way homemade radios, spark gap transmitter, built that ages and ages ago, a lot of different things, and anything from a bone stock CB at 4 watts to legal limit amateur radio 1500 watts. Done a lot of JK installs and learned a lot about how finicky they can be. Two Jeeps can be completely different than each other, and you can be installing the exact same components sometimes. So they can be interesting at times, and Chris reached out to me to give him a hand, give him some advice, and help him out.
What he didn't say is everybody calls him when they're installing a radio or a CB or something like that. So he, right now, is going to solder on a new end on this coax I just cut.
We're going super fancy, and we're not going to do a solder connection. We're going to do a crimp connection.
Oh, doing a crimp, even better.
So what I like to do is you've got this little crimp ferrule. Can't forget that. You put that on, you get everything on, and it makes your day miserable. With these, I like to put a piece of shrink wrap on there to act as a strain relief. So we'll get that on there to put on last. And then we have our connection ring or threaded ring and our actual connector. Basically, coax is coaxial. Two conductors on the same axis. You have the center conductor that actually carries the RF power and this outer shield, and that is your ground. And what we'll do is we'll strip that back in steps, and then it will slide right onto this connector, and then we'll crimp it on. So basically what we got here is I've stripped back the center conductor. You have to leave a little bit of the center insulator. There's a little bit of this blue and silver stuff, which is actually a secondary shield. And then you peel the shield back and feeds through the center, sets down on there. You can see it comes out the center there. Take your handy dandy crimper, crimp that. There we go.
All right, so everything is in. Got the antenna on. Look at that. That is pretty clean, if I do say so myself. So again, this is the Rugged Radios JK A-pillar mount. This is a Wilson 3/8 inch NMO coax. This is a diamond something or another. I'll put all the stuff in the description so you can find it. But got all that ran, and back to here. This is sort of the staging area. The actual installs gonna go inside this locked compartment, but I can fit the cables through here. So we're staging it here where it's convenient. Otherwise, poor Chris would have to lay back there inside there. So we don't want to do that to him. All right, so we've got the head, the remote head for the unit. Everything is plugged in. Have the mic in, and then Chris has his
Shortcom. It's a VHF, UHF. SWR meter. It's just digital.
So Chris has his VHF, UHF, SWR meter in here. This is different than one for CBs?
Yes. Typically your CB one, there's a tuned circuit inside the meter itself, and your typical CB meter is only good up to a maximum of 30 megahertz. We're working with 2 meters and 440 ham here, which is 144 megahertz, so we're quite a bit outside of that range, so you need a specific meter to do that.
Awesome. All right, so what are we looking for? We're looking for
anything, typically a rule of thumb is anything below SWR of 1.5 to 1. And that standing SWR is just a ratio between what would be ideal between the feed point, which is where the coax attaches to the antenna, and the radio itself, and also the antenna. It's 1.0 to 1 would be a perfectly tuned antenna. It's technically only in theory that you can have a perfect antenna with no losses at all. And basically that means your antenna is the exact right length at 50 ohms for that frequency. And your standing wave ratio is the ratio between what should be perfect and what it actually is. Anything below 1.5 is acceptable.
Nice. All right, so let's power the radio on. All right, so we have gone ahead and programmed both of these sides on the simplex. So we'll start with the 2 meter first. That's 146.520 is what we're using. And then we'll switch over to the 70 centimeter and do 446. And then basically all I'm gonna do is key the mic and we're gonna see what the meter shows. Let me just make sure. Okay. Set my squelch, we've got stuff going on. All right, so I'm gonna key the mic now. Transmitting. And we're at 1.35 to 9.
Yep, 1.3. Yeah, 1.3 to 1, 1.4.
48 watts. That's it's on high wattage, which it says right there that H. So that's seems like a good thing, right?
Yep. Yeah, we're right in where we need to be.
All right, let's switch. And let's key up on 446. We're about 155, 158 at 50 watts.
Yep. Perfectly.
Probably can't get much better than that, huh, with what we have going on? What should I change if I wanted to get that better?
The only way to change SWR, and I know that there's probably going to be some people that want to try and argue this, the only way to truly change SWR is change the length of the antenna. Some people will argue if I change the length of the coax, it changes the SWR. No, it doesn't. It changes the indicated SWR. It does not change the SWR. When you change a standing wave, the only way to do that is to change it at the antenna.
Well, this doesn't look adjustable, so.
I could get into a lot of the theory behind it and explain it, and if people want to ask questions, I'll be more than happy to address them in the comments, but the only way to change it is change the length of the antenna. Diamond makes a very good antenna. It shows basic installation. We're at less than 1.5 SWR on the simplex calling frequencies. We could go through and check how broadbanded the antenna is, do things like that. But I think if we're at 1.5 on the calling frequencies, you'll be good to go.
All right, so I guess the one thing that we needed to address was I had heard, actually somebody had posted a comment in the install video for this bracket, that the antenna being in such close proximity to that A-pillar might cause interference problems, and may on some Jeeps, but doesn't seem to be that big of a deal on mine. So I'm leaving this guy right here, which I'm super thankful for, because I'd have to cut this coax to run it back out. So. Yeah, so that's the final install for the antenna. Yeah, I don't see why we'd want to change it.
It's not worth the results of getting a lower SWR in this case. Mathematically, you can run all kinds of numbers and, you know, quote percentages and things like that. In the real world, going from 1.5 to 1.2, the only person that's ever going to notice the difference is you and your meter. On a repeater, on calling frequency simplex, no one's ever going to notice it.
Nice. Okay. All right. Well, we should test this thing and put some noise through the airwaves.
Yeah. Let's make some noise.
All right. Just quick local radio test. I've got it on simplex 146.520, and we have this guy. We have this guy set up on the same. So this is my Bofeng. Don't tell anybody I have that. and we're gonna do a radio check. And 7 CPO radio check.
Sounds good, N7 CPO and 3 VDN.
Nice. So I don't know if you guys could hear that, but we did a successful test locally, of course. Next thing I need to do is program this in for all the repeaters. I can download the repeater list that has an SD card slot that will allow me to just send them in there. But that's not what this video is about. Last thing I'll show you, after some magic, will be its final resting location. I'm going to run an extension for the mic, and actually the head unit cable is long enough, and then I've got to run an extension for my speaker, which is over there. So yeah, I'll do all that, show you the finished install, and then soon I'm going to do a separate video on your communication options. I'm going to give you all your options. There's probably about this many of them, licensed and unlicensed. Actually, unlicensed and licensed, if you want to get technical. So anyway, more to come on that.
All right, let me show you the final placement of this guy. Way up in there. So it is held magnetically to the side skin of the diabolical cover. Those are 5, like 68-pound magnets. So I'm hoping that, you know, jarring drops aren't going to be enough to pull that off. As you can see, I have plenty of room back here. I have the ability to unplug the power, and then I have the ability to reach around here and get to the other cables, including the SD card. Now, why I picked that spot is for a couple reasons. Number one, it's secured, right? So I'm inside the security enclosure. If you look back here from the front of the vehicle, sorry for the sun, I mean, here all my cables are coming through. That's all I have. You can't get to the radio at all from anywhere. And of course, in the back, and this is all closed and locked with the tailgate, this whole area is inaccessible. So that, plus being tucked up there, it's completely out of the way of the rest of the cargo area. So I'm throwing things around back here. It's out of the way. I do have a little bit of room underneath it. There's a tool roll. So actually something cushioning might not be bad to have right there, just in case, but I don't think it'll ever come off. The other thing I did is I added some weather stripping around the front of this roll bar cover where it meets the slipstream skin. And it's not gonna make it waterproof, but it's gonna prevent any direct water from just like flowing through there. But I have this as far away from that area as I can get, and then tucked up in that corner over there where it's sealed on all the sides from the top. So anyway, I think that's a great spot, and I'm super happy with how that turned out. As far as my cable run, they're all coming through, and they're running along here with the existing bundle. What I don't have figured out just yet, and I'm probably not going to do it right away, is so my microphone, my head unit, and my speaker wires. I'm pretty sure I'm going to shoot those across to the center console, and leave the rest of this alone. But because I have a couple more things to install, for example, I'm putting in a Tuffy security box, which is actually gonna be used to store this head when I'm not using it in the Jeep. I wanted to have a secure place to keep that so it doesn't get stolen. That's gonna go under here. And so before I start running these wires and bundling them, I need to figure out, I think that I have to move some of this stuff for the Tuffy. So I'm sort of laying low right now. The mic extension is a standard, I think it's a Cat 6 network extension I got off Amazon. So I'll put a link for that. But the mic just plugs in to this, I think it's a 15, 14 foot extension, something like that. Works great.
So far I haven't needed an extension for the head unit, but it's just a standard telephone plug, so you can use a telephone extension for those of you that still know what that is. And then for my speaker, I have a, I think it's a 15 foot, just 1/8 inch extension. Right now, oddly enough, my speaker is right here hanging out. It's zip tied to my bar tacked cover, and it usually just hangs like that. That was a temporary thing I did one day. I was going on a trip and didn't have time to permanently mount that. It's been up there ever since. So I'm gonna permanently mount this somewhere. I'm not positive where yet. I wanna mount it up here, like right here, using this grab bar and then the top of the roll cage, so that it's basically pointing down in between the two seats. But I'll get to that one day. Anyway, guys, I think that's it for now. I'll, if you're interested, I'll do another radio video showing. Showing the features of this ID-5100. It's pretty freaking amazing. I don't know how else to say it. It's really cool. But that's it, guys. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you on the next one.